Hello, everyone. Welcome to Duel of the Takes. Today, we're doing something a little different. We are going to be making a tier list for all of the Rankin Bass animated television specials from the 1960s, 70s, and 80s.
I'm very excited. I love Christmas.
I'm looking forward to the results of this. I think this could get interesting.
Yeah, this is going to get real weird.
I feel like when you said Rankin Bass Christmas specials, I thought of like three. And then the fourth was like, oh, also Little Drummer Boy. And I'm looking at these thumbnails like, what the fuck?
Why is the last thumbnail just the presidential debate this past year?
I don't know. Maybe we should ask the higher beings that are in charge of everything.
Speaking of the higher beings that are in charge of everything, the five tiers that I have created for this, and we can always create more, obviously, if something doesn't quite fit in this caliber. The top tier is the deserved classics, movies that should have the recognition that they do, or maybe perhaps deserve more. We've got the probably all right tier, which,
probably all right.
Up next, we've got the perfect middle tier, boomer food. Is Lay Off the Weed a reoccurring tier from our conspiracy theory tier list? I think there's also going to be a couple of movies that fit in this mold as well. There's also the unwatchable tier. So, yeah, I'm thinking some of these might make it there as well. Rankin Bass, the writers obviously were American, and some of the animation was done in America, but most of it was outsourced to Japan. So these are technically animes.
Cool. Based Christmas anime. All right, so here's our anime tier list for all of you who have been asking for it.
Starting off, the first special, Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer. What can I say about this one that hasn't been said already? Everyone fucking knows this one, even if you haven't seen it.
Rudolph gets exiled from the North Pole and shit. And then, they find the Island of Misfit Toys in this one, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, like that, like all of that shit. I feel like
Rudolph is Moses.
I feel like this one has to be a deserved classic. Like, there's no way.
I know we're... This isn't on the list, but I just want to know, what's everybody's quick thoughts on Rudolph 2?
Are you talking about the computer animated Rudolph sequel?
Yes.
Yeah, that's not on here, but that's cool. I like it.
When I look up Rudolph 2, it shows me the Holy Roman Emperor.
We have the 1966 Thanksgiving-ish special, The Ballad of Smokey the Bear. The slow success of Rudolph, the United States Forest Services commissioned a Thanksgiving-timed animated TV movie as a part of the General Electric Fantasy Hour on NBC. The story is told by Smokey's older brother, voiced by James Cagney, who narrates the origin story of Smokey the Bear, which apparently involves a gang of woodland critters being tormented by a gorilla that escaped from the zoo. The gorilla has pyromaniac tendencies and sets a cabin on fire, and Smokey, as a wee little cub in a big hat, puts out the fire and takes the gorilla back to the zoo.
Why is there a Thanksgiving special commissioned by the armed forces starring Smokey the Bear?
No, the United States Forest Services.
Oh, the Forest Services. I thought you said the Forest Services, and I was like, that's a weird way to say that.
Who wins in a fight, Smokey the Bear or Cool Cat?
If Cool Cat sneaks up on Smokey, then Cool Cat. But if they like see each other from 10 paces and then engage in a fight, it's going to be Smokey.
It's definitely Smokey.
Yeah, Smokey's kind of a chat. But this movie sounds like it sucks. This sounds a little unwatchable to me.
I would say unwatchable, but his name is Smokey. You gotta lay off the weed, bro.
The animation is really bad. It was the first of these that was 2D animated by Rankin Bass, and it really shows. The coloring is, it looks like shit.
It's probably the best like Thanksgiving interpretation is the Charlie Brown Thanksgiving.
Oh yeah, because it doesn't try to tell any of that like origin shit. It's simply like Charlie Brown and his homies making dinner.
Every time anybody tries to tell the Thanksgiving story, it's always like a little sus.
So a month after The Mouse on the Mayflower, The Little Drummer Boy came out in 1968.
Fuck this movie.
Yeah, so I fucking hate this special.
I also do. Did you also watch this in Catholic school?
Damn, I think my Catholic school was based. I did not watch this in school. I think I watched...
You know what I did watch in church?
What?
I watched The Passion of the Christ when I was like 12.
Holy shit.
So how do we feel about The Little Drummer Boy?
Fuck this movie. It's unwatchable. If we had a tier below unwatchable that was like send to the bowels of hell, like that's where this movie belongs. Lump of coal tier.
Up next, another classic. We've got Frosty the Snowman, the 2D animated 1969 special. Perhaps the second most iconic film on this list. Who knows? It might be more iconic than Rudolph.
Yeah, I think this is one of like the timeless movies that, I mean, you could show any generation of kids and they will watch. And it's a really good theme.
What's the theme?
Magic is real and Christmas is real.
Yeah, I think the villain that tries to steal his hat is a big old meme.
Deserved classic. Certified classic.
Yeah,
there it is. We're moving on to Santa Claus is Coming to Town, the 1970 stop motion classic. I think this is probably one of the best ones. In fact, I think this is better than both Rudolph and Frosty.
Yeah, I agree. I love this movie.
This is like my headcanon for like Santa Claus.
I mean, come on. There's a character called Burgermeister. Just put one foot in front of the other.
That song's a banger.
It's so good.
The 2005 DVD release included a CD single of Mariah Carey performing the title song.
Ew. So this is getting a spot at the top of deserved classics for now.
Yeah, definitely. Three kings up there.
Here comes Peter Cottontail, the original Easter Bunny. Colonel Wellington B. Bunny names Peter Cottontail to be his replacement, who is completely incompetent, boastful, and a lying, deceitful bunny. Despite these negative traits, all the other rabbits just are chill with the fact that Peter Cottontail gets the nom. Except one, January Q. Irontail, an evil reclusive bunny who lives in a tree with his sidekick, Montrezor the Bat. His tragic backstory involves losing a tail in a roller skating accident as a child. Wellington B. Bunny allows the next Easter Bunny to be determined via a face-off to see who can deliver more eggs.
Wait a second. So are you telling me that the Easter Bunny has the same hierarchy as Black Panther?
Yes. Actually, this is Black Panther before Black Panther. This is the Black Panther of the Rankin-Bass cinematic universe.
The Killmonger looks exactly like this universe's Waluigi.
I think I've seen this special.
So let's go with Boomer Food.
It's about a group of trickster kids who fool an emperor into paying for a suit that doesn't exist. You can only see the suit if you're educated, so the emperor pretends that he can see it so he doesn't look stupid, and then he exposes himself to his educated council because he wears his new suit that isn't actually a suit, it's nothing. The kids then shoot their gold payment to the streets of impoverished and poor citizens and redistribute the emperor's wealth. One of the pranksters marries the king's daughter, Jane, and that's literally the end of the story. How do we feel about The Enchanted World of Danny Kaye, The Emperor's New Clothes?
You know what? This one might probably be all right. Like, it's not bad. It doesn't strike me as what the fuck, like everything else has.
Yeah, it sounds like kind of a mess, but I think probably all right does sound accurate.
I like the theming of, like, exposing corrupt politicians and redistributing their wealth.
Yeah.
I think it's definitely watchable. By the sound of it,
I feel like I don't want to sit this next to fucking like Black Panther Easter Bunny.
It's yeah, I'm not feeling Boomer Food from it.
All right. Speaking of things that probably aren't all right, we're moving on to the 1972 2D animated Mad Monster. The hotel bellhop Harvey is revealed to have been hallucinating the entire story, recalling it to his therapist, Dr. Jekyll.
Holy shit.
His therapist then transforms into Mr. Hyde, and all the monsters start chasing Harvey as the credits roll.
I do think that Hotel Transylvania is probably all right.
It reminded me of that Scooby-Doo spinoff special where Shaggy with a red shirt and Scooby go to that, like, is it a hotel or house full of, like, monster girls or something?
Scooby-Doo's Ghoul School or some shit like that.
I don't remember that.
Yeah, Shaggy had the red shirt when Scrappy was with the gang.
It was literally a red flag.
Well, it sounds probably all right, judging by our Scooby-Doo anecdote.
These are all just like wedding guests, and then they get triggered at the hotel staff and chase him.
Is it Boomer Food then?
Actually, Yes, it is.
Yeah.
Sounds like a boomer move.
The Year Without Santa Claus starts off with Santa having a cold. His narcissistic doctor thinks he should give up because no one believes in him anymore, and he should focus on his own health.
The doc said all that negative stuff, then he's just going to say Merry Christmas.
Fuck you, buddy. Merry Christmas.
The bumbling elves then visit the snow miser to see if he'll make it to Snowtown. He says he would love to, but it's property of the Heat Miser. So then they visit the Heat Miser, who says he'll trade Southtown for the North Pole on Christmas Day. Then the Heat Miser and Snow Miser start feuding again. Then Mrs. Claus goes full boss bitch and talks to the Miser's mother, Mother Nature, who clears up the argument.
Oh my God.
But one little girl cries, saying she'll have a blue Christmas without Santa. The crying of this one little girl changes Santa's whole perspective on the situation, and on Christmas Eve, he decides last minute to forfeit his own health and continue selflessly giving to every child of the world.
This is truly the dark night of Christmas specials. Like, can you name a more perfect trilogy?
I don't think it's as good as the first one, honestly. I think
really,
Santa Claus is Coming to Town is better. It's more balanced than The Year Without Santa Claus, in my opinion.
This is 2020. Like, Santa's got COVID-19 in this special.
So this has huge boomer food vibes, just in terms of the theming.
Hell no. This is a deserved classic.
Compromise your health for the children of the earth. Business is more important than your body.
Absolutely. Only when it's Christmas.
A very libertarian Christmas.
Yeah, Nate, you should love this shit. What the hell?
Now, doctor.
Are we in agreement besides Alden, who thinks this is another deserved classic?
I think for now, it's got to go at the end of deserved classics, though.
I think it can at least go above Frosty.
Agreed. I like the characters in this way more than I like any of the unnamed children in Frosty's animated thing.
That's true. It's
all right, you got me there.
Like, I mean, like, think about it. Just like original characters in a holiday special, you don't get better than Heat Miser and Snow Miser.
Up next, 'Twas the Night Before Christmas. Around the turn of the 20th century, Santa is offended by an anonymous letter published in a newspaper saying that Santa doesn't exist. Father Mouse suspects his nerdy rat son Albert is behind this article.
I'm pretty sure I have seen it.
I think we need to lay off the weed.
I have not seen this.
Yeah.
I actually think this sounds probably all right.
Albert, the fucking atheist asshole mouse, then sneaks back into the clock tower and makes the fixes needed to the clock exactly 1 minute after midnight. So then Santa gets untriggered, removes the log from his ass, turns the sleigh around, and then fills all the kids' stockings with presents, like, literally last minute.
You know, I think this movie is probably all right because I'm looking at some clips from it, and it prominently features a whole black family in this town, which, for 1974, I didn't expect. So how bad could it really be?
Well, it takes place at the turn of the 20th century, so they were probably indentured servants.
They were probably a little less than indentured servants, if we want to be real. But I like that they're there.
I don't know. I think this is personally boomer food. I don't like the way that Santa acts in this special, where he's like triggered and then is like, fuck you guys, I'm not serving your town, because one person's like, fuck Santa, all my homies hate Santa.
You know, when you put it that way, yeah, this is boomer food. Santa is the ultimate boomer in this special.
Santa's just a Karen in this special. I will say it's probably better than the other two things we currently have in boomer food.
Okay.
I'm okay with this being at the top of boomer food. What do you think, Josh?
It's not as problematic as the other two.
All right. Who's ready for probably one of the worst specials on this entire thing?
Oh, bet.
The First Christmas, 1975. In the horribly misleading title production, a young shepherd named Lucas gets blinded by a bolt of lightning while protecting his flock of sheep. Some nuns then decide to rescue him and take him to a stable. Sister Teresa then describes what snow is to Lucas, who has never seen it, and probably never will, because now he's fucking blind. Lucas then gets guilted into being a part of the church's Christmas pageant, where he gets cast as an angel. While performing in the pageant, it snows, and a small miracle happens. I'm not sure if that means Lucas gets his vision back, but in my headcanon, that's what happened. And then the characters sing White Christmas. That's it.
Wait, what?
That's the whole plot.
Okay, well, I'm just going to slap it into unwatchable.
If it were made today by, like, an art house director, this could be, like, Christmas Kino.
You're right, actually.
Like, this sounds like Oscar bait. And I would watch it.
This sounds like A24's first Christmas movie.
I would watch the shit out of this. This is like Doubt meets Miracle on 34th Street.
Who are we casting in this A24 live action remake?
Timothée Chalamet.
Yes, Lucas is played by Timothée Chalamet. Sister Teresa is Bryce Dallas Howard.
Okay. I like that. Good choice.
Me too.
The old nun is like fucking Frances McDormand or some shit.
Yes, yes. Exactly who I was thinking as like the bitchier nun.
Yeah, I'd watch this.
Yeah, this is kind of Kino. Guess who's back?
Uh-oh.
The devil?
The Little Drummer Boy Book 2, the year after. The much anticipated sequel to The Little Drummer Boy is just as lame and depressing as it sounds. This is a surprisingly libertarian take on the Christmas story, and I think it is supposed to represent the persecution of early Christians and the Jewish people, but doesn't really commit to anything drastic. The movie ends kind of like The Grinch Who Stole Christmas, the good one, the animated one, not the god-awful Ron Howard movie starring Jim Carrey, but this ends with the music of bells and drums echoing through the street and lifting everyone's spirits.
I kind of want to put this higher than the first one just because at one point he gets his drums and stakes burned. It's like catharsis.
Surprisingly, I think this might be better than the first one.
I'm perfectly fine with this going in unwatchable.
You know what else happened in 1968?
What?
Martin Luther King was shot, and I'm trying to find a connection.
Is it better or worse than the mouse on the Mayflower?
Let's say better because of the Romans.
Better because there are less atrocities.
The 1976 sequel, Frosty's Winter Wonderland, despite having fun all day with the kids, Frosty becomes deeply lonely and depressed every night and starts crying. The kids start bullying him for being a fucking incel like the Little Drummer Boy. But then they decide to help him and build him a snowman wife and name her Crystal. Frosty and Crystal then begin terrorizing the town, flaunting their wedding invitations. Then the clergyman, Parson Brown, the bigoted asshole, says he can't marry the snow couple because they aren't, quote-unquote, real people.
Kind of like this Democratic Party viewed same-sex couples until they needed to cover something up.
So then Frosty and Crystal build a second Parson out of snow, and Parson Brown puts a Bible in his hand, giving us perhaps the most overtly religious propaganda out of all of these films. A parson's not a parson until he's got a Bible in his hand. Jack then shows up and says he's going to ruin the wedding with a blizzard. And then Frosty's like, nah, be my best man instead. The special ends with the snow couple and Jack going honeymooning to the North Pole. They wish everyone a wonderful and frosty winter. I'm just left to assume that this whole special is a message about promoting polyamorous relationships.
I kind of want to put this in Lay Off the Weed.
I think this says a lot about the artificial nature of our own existence and our desires and our faith and what we believe in and why we believe in what we do. I think that this could definitely be remade by A24. Can't stop, won't stop. I can't just not read into this shit now.
Okay, so do you guys remember how I said there are multiple attempts at giving us an Easter Bunny origin story on this list?
Gross.
This is called The Easter Bunny Is Coming to Town. So then SD Kluger sings the hit song Easter Bunny Is Coming to Town. It's the same song as Santa Claus Is Coming to Town. I shit you not. They just changed some of the words. The origin of Easter begins in a town called Kidville, run by a pack of wild orphans. One day, the kids find an orphaned bunny and name him Sunny because he likes to sit in the sun.
Was this getting so whack?
Sunny goes to sell some eggs, and a homeless guy named Hallelujah Jones says he should sell them. On the way to town, he climbs Big Rock Mountain and gets jumped by Gadzooks the bear. Sonny gets to town, and it's dreary and sucks, and a crippled child king named Bruce the Frail takes the throne. Sonny hands out Easter eggs to everyone, and the king names him the Easter Bunny. In order to keep Easter interesting, the following year, Sonny the Easter Bunny then teams up with the homeless guy named Hallelujah Jones and some random baker who has not been yet introduced to the film to create the first ever jelly beans. The next Easter, Sonny and the baker need to make Easter interesting again and bake chocolate bunnies. And there is such a high demand for the Easter cheer that everyone piles onto SD Kluger's train, and then they recreate the little engine that could every single year to deliver Easter presents on time.
Fuck this movie. If there was a layoff the shrooms tier.
Yeah.
For now, I think that this is the first one that actually deserves to be in layoff the week.
I'm feeling the same way.
Nestor, the long-eared Christmas donkey. So here it goes. Set in the days of the Roman Empire, a long-eared donkey named Nestor gets bullied for having long ears. As the animals celebrate the winter solstice, and Nestor's mom gives him socks. And then some Roman soldiers come and fuck shit up, kill a bunch of animals, including Nestor's mom, who sacrifices herself for him. Nestor's all sad and shit. It rips off Bambi for like 3 minutes, and he like runs around crying. And then an angel shows up and tells Nestor, "Your ears can do wondrous things no other ears can do. The sounds they hear will guide you on a path that's straight and true, and then you will save another as your mother once saved you." So then Nestor gets bought at a flea market by Mary and Joseph because of his quote-unquote kind eyes and because he was the only donkey on sale and they were flat broke. And on their way to Bethlehem, a sandstorm starts and only Nestor can navigate because he can hear good. He can hear so good that he's able to navigate in a sandstorm. So his ears are so good he can navigate through a sandstorm. So Mary can then give birth to baby Grogu.
When are Nestor and the little drummer boy going to show up in The Mandalorian?
Season 3. I like the fact that it ripped off Bambi and Rudolph and still sucks.
I like that Santa is Asian in this movie.
Mickey Rooney voices Santa, and then they went with Mickey Rooney's Asian stereotype character from Breakfast at Tiffany's and made him Santa.
From Breakfast at Tiffany's. Oh, that's fucked.
I think it's lay off the weed.
I think it's boomer food just because, like, it's just Rudolph, but more biblical.
I just don't understand how the science works. Because he has big ears, he can hear through a sandstorm.
That one scene deserves to be in layoff the week.
Time for the 1978 special, The Stingiest Man in Town. This is the Rankin Bass take on A Christmas Carol, all told from the perspective of B.A. Humbug, or Bah Humbug, a tiny Jiminy Cricket ripoff who lives in Ebenezer Scrooge's office. And it doesn't take too many noticeable changes from other adaptations of A Christmas Carol, but Scrooge is voiced by prime Walter Matthau, and it also recycles a lot of 2D animation from Twas the Night Before Christmas. That's all I got.
Sounds like some boomer food to me.
Yeah, sounds very boomer food.
All right, we're moving on to Rudolph's Shiny New Year. Do you guys remember this one, the Rudolph sequel? Because it's got quite the synopsis.
Is this the Baby New Year one?
It fucking is.
Oh, holy shit, who is that? I saw him in a thumbnail right as you said his name.
Santa asks Rudolph to help Father Time find the New Year's baby before midnight of New Year's Eve. Otherwise, it will permanently be December 31st forever. Eon tries to murder Rudolph, but is saved by Big Ben, a sperm whale with a clock on his back. And then Rudolph travels to these archipelagos of time, which are essentially these islands that are memories of the past, and each one of them represents their time period. So then he goes ahead to 1776 Island, because what important thing happened in 1776? Represented as Colonial American Island, celebrates American Independence Day on a daily basis with none of the Revolutionary War.
Sounds like my house.
And then 1776 lives here, and it's literally just it's Ben Franklin. Because 1893 was indeed an unhappy time, as a major economic depression called the Panic of 1893 hit the United States that year.
Oh no.
The housing crisis of 2008 Island.
People in 2008 didn't know what the word happy meant.
Dude, you think that's bad? 2020 Island. They didn't even celebrate Thanksgiving.
The people in 2020 Island don't know what outside means.
The first meeting of the Independent Labor Party in the United Kingdom was in 1893.
Of course it was. That's the reason there was the Giant Depression. And then they go to the final island, 1965 Island, where Rudolph stated that this island was too noisy to search for happy. Among the noisy world events of 1965 included Beatlemania and other British invasion-related hysteria, as well as growing opposition to the United States' involvement in the Vietnam War.
Wait a second. Is that actually touched on in this movie?
Yes. Yes, it is. And then Rudolph finds the baby and saves the day.
This is bold as fuck.
It's really not. Rudolph traveled back to 1776 and said nothing about slavery, despite OM being with him.
That's because he agreed with it.
Oh, no. This is
Rudolph is a slave, Nate.
This is boomer food.
This is literally the biggest shark jump in Rudolph. Like,
I mean, it absolutely is. But I think that they're so committed to it. Like, it has to be probably all right. I would probably argue for it to be a deserved classic if I had seen it.
Jack Frost, an immortal winter pixie, falls in love with a woman named Eliza, but he can't talk to her because he's not human. So Father Winter gives him a chance, but warns him that Jack must prove he can succeed as a human by earning a house, a horse, a bag of gold, and a wife by the first sign of spring. Jack gives up his immortality to then destroy the army and freeze them all to death, which he does.
Oh my God.
What?
Jack then races off to ask Eliza's hand in marriage after giving up everything and killing thousands of men to have her. And she doth protest because she loves Sir Ravenel, some random simp that lives in the tower with Eliza. So that's Jack Frost.
This movie sounds like Frozen, but like there's a male protagonist.
Tell us why when I searched images for Jack Frost, I got a picture of some animated e-boy and his bare feet. Rise of the Guardian.
I think Jack Frost does have to save someone. I don't remember it that well.
I don't like the ending at the end where he gets cucked, though. That part pisses me off because it promotes incel culture. I mean, this man literally killed an entire army to have this lady's hand in marriage and she friend zones him.
I think that it was his fault for simping in the first place.
Yeah, I'm going to blame him.
You're right. Josh, would you watch Jack Frost?
No.
Would you watch Jack Frost with Michael Keaton?
Yes.
Would you watch the Rankin Bass Jack Frost if Michael Keaton voiced Jack Frost in it?
like Chick Hicks style?
Up next, we've got Pinocchio's Christmas, 1980. This is pretty much a special of Pinocchio getting a cool gift and then getting peer pressured by his friends Fox and Cat into making a bad choice with said cool gift over and over again. The fox and cat convince Pinocchio to go to the North Pole and teach Santa's toys how to dance. So Pinocchio goes all the way to the North Pole and then gets boxed up by elves who think he's a toy and try to give him out to boys and girls at Christmas. And then Santa realizes, like, night of, while delivering these presents, that he is indeed not a toy and is a real boy.
It was pretty scary.
Yeah.
Josh, would you watch the Ari Aster remake of Pinocchio's Christmas?
I would.
That moment when the elves grab him and shove him into a box would be extremely similar to the moment where those old people jump off a cliff.
Here it is. The 1981 hit, The Leprechaun's Christmas Gold. There are two factions of leprechauns, the gold miners and the shoemakers. The head of each faction gets married to bring the clans together. Then some sailors show up looking for a pine tree to celebrate Christmas and some centuries-old banshee that lives under one of the trees that the leprechauns have to sacrifice their gold to every year was living in a tree and was then unearthed. The banshee then poisons the sailor to give him the gold, and he does. But it takes the banshee too long to eat the gold, and she turns into tears. Then the sailor gave the leprechauns back their gold and sailed them home to Ireland.
This is a really weird rendition of the Lorax.
I'm going to say it.
Wait, no. Is this an A24 remake?
I think it is.
All right. Who's ready for the third and final Easter Bunny origin story attempt?
This one's unwatchable.
The first Easter Rabbit, the 1982 origin story of the Easter Bunny. A little girl named Glinda gets ill with scarlet fever, and all of her toys are thrown away, including Stuffy the Bunny, her favorite, a gift from Santa. Zero, some evil ice wizard, wants to freeze over Easter Valley, so Stuffy does what all heroes should and becomes the Easter Bunny and scares him away. Santa then begins bargaining with Zero and gives him real estate in the South Pole, causing Zero to go away forever.
I said it was going to be unwatchable before. Maybe I'm just shitting on the Easter Bunny because I don't like him, but like, you know what? The synopsis and the animation that I'm seeing here, this movie's probably all right. Oh, I just saw an animation cycle repeat badly.
Oh no, it's moving down to boomer food tier.
Oh fuck. Damn, as the movie goes through, like, you can see them like running out of money.
The Avengers Endgame of the Rankin-Bass cinematic universe, starring Rudolph, Frosty, Crystal, Santa, Mrs. Claus, Jack Frost, and even cameos by the Heat and Snow Miser. This story follows an evil warlock named Winter Bolt, who is trying to assassinate Santa while the rest of the friends celebrate their holiday contributions in a parade in the middle of July.
Yeah, I just love that this video is like Rudolph versus Winter Bolt. Like, it's an epic, like, superhero battle.
Yeah, I mean, Winter Bolt, of all the enemies in these movies, he's certainly the most intimidating. He's got like actual powers and shit. His objective is literally to kill Santa so that way Winter can be his.
He's like Thanos if Thanos wasn't just like strong guy.
I love that the runtime for this one is almost 100 minutes.
Yeah, it's the conclusion of the Rudolph trilogy, and it's also the conclusion of the Frosty trilogy. They really like put all their eggs in one basket. A lot of people consider this to be the last like Rankin-Bass movie too. Like, there was a short-lived era after, but this was really kind of the end of it all. Kind of like how people are going to see the MCU in 10 years.
Yeah.
When Black Widow finally releases in theaters and people are like, who the fuck cares?
I think this is probably all right.
Yeah, I agree. I think that this is probably all right.
The final movie. So what do you do with a cinematic universe after you've had your big epic conclusion?
You make a prequel that should have come out 10 years before. You
make Black Widow.
But here's what they did instead. The Life and Adventures of Santa Claus, 1985. They decided to go back to the origins of Santa Claus and have a gritty reboot.
Oh, no.
Therefore, there is a whole battle between good and evil as Klaus tries to deliver presents. It's kind of cringe.
This is what I would expect from like a live action remake.
I feel like this deserves to be just under the second Rudolph movie in Lay Off the Weed.
Yeah, it's definitely Lay Off the Weed tier.
I feel like this is what I think Rise of the Guardians is like.
I would rather see either of those than this movie. If it's up to me, I think that The Life and Adventures of Santa Claus can either go an unwatchable or lump of coal. I mean, it killed the Rankin-Bass TV special deal. They were no longer asked to make holiday specials after this. All right, so here's our tier list.
Hell yeah.
You know, it's kind of nice that the deserved classics is the category with the second most movies in it.
It's also like those are probably the four that people know going into this. And I think it's interesting how like
those four have, I guess, probably aged the best because they're like the ones that they still play.
Yeah, they feel the most timeless, where like I think all of them in the boomer food feel so dated,
which is why they're in boomer food.
Well, thank you, everyone, for listening to our tier list, and if you're watching along on YouTube, be sure to check out our podcast. Links in the description. Special thanks to our guest Julie for joining us.
She was really quiet today.
Have a Merry Christmas, everyone.